small flocks are over. All the Zion's mountain, from whom no secrets are hid, flatters the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear our Lord Jesus Christ said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law.
Be fitful, be courageous,
not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you, if ye be followers of that which is good? But that if ye suffer, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, caring to do this.
Thanks be to God.
Be God in love, His Father, before all worlds.
O Lord our God, whose glory is in all the world, we command this nation thy merciful care, that being guided by thy prophets, we may dwell secure in thy peace. Grant to the President of the United States and all in authority, wisdom and strength to know and to do thy will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness, and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in thy fear. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Amen. O Lord God of hosts, stretch forth, we pray thee, thine almighty arm, to strengthen and protect the armed forces of our country. Support them in the day of battle, and in the time of peace, keep them safe from all evil. Endue them with courage and loyalty, and grant that in all things they may serve without reproach, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thine immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all at once. Good morning. A couple of announcements. You'll notice there's a special pull-out section of your bulletin featuring some details about the Night in Provence event that the Wells and Qualls are sponsoring for July. Take good note that there is 30 reservations. There'll be 30 people allowed at this exclusive event. Please keep that in mind. Looking further into the year, you'll also notice that we're planning on having an event kind of every month. Idea of fellowship and time to invite guests and to have them enjoy the time here with us as well. Also, in technology news, our website now has a blog feature which allows us to not only put sermons, the manuscripts online, but also the audio of the sermon. So if any time during the week or if you miss a Sunday you'd like to catch up on that, those are available there. And we're also now live streaming our services, for instance right now. We're live streaming the service, and so people, not only do we get messages from people crazy all over the world who view these services where they can't get access to an Anglican service, but whenever anyone's out of town, they can access this and pray along with us in live time. These also be recordings as well for later on. Now, the words are not the meditation of our heart, but always accepted my sight, the Lord, my strength, and my redeemer. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, Lord." St. Luke 5:8. The gospel reading appointed for today comes to us from the 5th chapter of St. Luke's account, and we find ourselves near the beginning of Christ's ministry, as our Lord travels from town to town, engaging in spiritual warfare against the forces of darkness that lay siege to our reality. The battlefield of this campaign against sin and death, like most battlefields, gains its significance from the combat that occurred there. No one would much care about Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, if not for the tens of thousands of our countrymen who lost their lives there. Galilee was not like that. It was a mountainous backwater of a section of the Roman Empire, only important to its colonial overlords because it served as a land bridge between the northern and southern sections of their sprawling holdings. This location is where the majority of Christ's life and ministry took place, and it is the scene of the engagements in chapter 4 and chapter 5 of Luke's Gospel. How Jesus wages war war against Satan may seem strange to those of us who normally associate combat with destruction and death. Ultimately, the war between Satan and Christ will bring death, for death is the great and final weapon of evil. However, Christ's lordship over life and death protects both him and his followers in a way that robs the serpent of his poison and shows the impotence of all his furious rages. But here in the beginning of his work, Jesus confronts Satan through three primary means. First, in the most direct way, by casting out demons. Secondly, by healing those whose bodies show the physical signs of our world being under siege, namely the sick and the lame. And finally, he teaches. He proclaims the arrival of the kingdom of God in the synagogues, in the mountains, and in the plains. Basically, any place we can go, he's proclaiming this kingdom of God. This last means of engagement, the preaching of the new heaven and the new earth, may seem to be the least impressive aspect of our Lord's ministry. After all, can't anyone preach? And no, that's not a poll. We should recognize that all of the miracles performed by Christ and his apostles are in service to this proclamation of the kingdom. Every powerful healing and dramatic confrontation with demonic forces fulfills the Old Testament prophecies and signals to the believing remnant within Judea that the Messiah has come. Further, they even have an effect upon the pagan Gentiles who recognize a power that cannot be contained within their superstitious worldviews and the powerful earthly armies they count upon. We must always remember that Christ's announcement of the arriving kingdom of God through preaching and teaching was what made the miracles matter, because they served that great proclamation like a melody serves to showcase the lyrics of a song. Further, the miracles were only temporary. The people Jesus healed or even raised from the grave still succumbed to the curse of human sin and departed from this earthly life. But the good news was that the death they would suffer was not an end, but a beginning. And not just the beginning of another life, as the Hindus would have us believe, but the beginning of a life as life was always meant to be. That truth is and was far more amazing than anyone being temporarily freed from death or disease. Unfortunately, I fear that when we approach God and ask for a miracle, whether it is for healing or even a heartfelt plea for mercy, we are sorely tempted to ignore the great banquet that awaits us in our future and pin our hopes and prayers upon this one more temporary respite from the death that awaits us all. Sadly, when that prayer for health or happiness or peace fails to immediately materialize, we are quick to turn on God and question his power or plan, or even to question his goodness. Where was my miracle? I'm a good person. I even go to church. Why didn't you heal my mother or help my brother or relieve me of this terrible burden? We ask these questions because we're human, and because we are never as faithful as holy as we think we are. And the terrible fear of abandonment haunts us still as a people separated from God by sin. Ultimately, we can too easily construct a false understanding of what miracles even are. For example, we might mistakenly believe that Jesus helps people he likes, or helps people because they are so good, and that this temporary help is why one becomes a Christian. This false construct, which I hear far too often, conceals the truth that miracles serve as concrete actions that signal the reality of the coming kingdom proclaimed by the living God. That is their whole purpose. As hard as this for us to accept, in the first century and in our own time, the immediate benefit of miracles really does not matter, except that it manifests the coming glory of all God's holy people will enjoy together, and the breaking through of that glory even now. That is not to say, though, that we are ungrateful to God when he helps us. We really should celebrate the recovered health of a loved one, whether through a direct miracle or through the gracious work of the Holy Spirit. in sight of the fact that this gracious act in our current life matters tremendously little, if not the great healing that will be administered in the life to come. The Christian gospel proclaims that whether one dies at 1 or 100, in battle or in sleep, among enemies or among friends, through disease or through murder, the gospel claims that our Lord has robbed these death of their power over us. That gospel of new life in the kingdom of God was what compelled people to follow Jesus during his earthly ministry. And we should never underestimate its power. In chapter 5, we see the eagerness of the people to hear Jesus. Notice how Luke begins the chapter. He writes, "On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God," St. Luke 5:1. Given the miracles in chapter 4, our modern sensibilities would lead us to assume that people have come primarily to be healed by Jesus. We could be tempted to imagine Jesus' popularity among the people deriving solely from his healing miracles, sort of like a first century traveling free clinic. However, Luke tells us that the crowd has not come for healing. They've come to hear the word of God. Again, the miracles point to the coming kingdom, a kingdom the occupied and oppressed people of Judea desperately want to see. And the miracles point to Jesus as the one who will usher that kingdom in. Miracles always serve the word of God, and the word is of utmost importance for all those who, in subjugation to both earthly tyranny and the tyranny of sin and death that always stands behind it. The narrative continues with Jesus stepping into a boat to gain some separation from the crowd in order to teach them more efficiently. It being morning, the fishermen were cleaning their nets from a hard night of fishing, and as we learn later, a frustrating and unsuccessful night of fishing. Simon Peter, the future apostle, rather surprisingly doesn't protest Jesus commandeering one of his boats for a sermon. Why? We should remember that one of Jesus' healing miracles in chapter 4 was the miraculous healing of Peter's mother-in-law. And afterward, while Jesus was staying in Peter's house, Peter had seen many signs that compelled him to hear more from this powerful man. The miracles drove him to hear the word of God. One interesting aspect of this sermon is that Luke does not give the sermon Jesus preached that morning. This absence should not trouble us, as Luke couldn't possibly have provided every sermon Jesus gave. However, it is highly likely that Jesus gave similar sermons as he traveled from location to location. These instances of repeated proclamations help explain why in Matthew, for instance, we find the Sermon on the Mount, and in Luke we find the Sermon on the Plain. These seem to be very different kinds of locations. This very basic feature of the traveling teacher, going from place to place and proclaiming the same gospel, somehow fails to register in the minds of people who compare these works and talk of inconsistencies between the gospel traditions. This makes my head explode every time I watch the History Channel. We don't have this sermon, but it would have probably been similar to the Sermon on the Plain in the next chapter, Luke 6, or the more extensive version found in Matthew 5-7. Very, very similar. After Jesus completes his sermon, he looks to Peter and commands him to put out the nets they had just cleaned and fish during the most unlikely time of the day for actually catching anything. Galilean fishermen, Lake Gennesaret, so the local name you see in Galilee. When they fish, they fish at night. It's cooler, and also you have more chance of catching fish in the lake. It's not a very clean one. Peter's answer to our Lord's entreaty is classic Peter. And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word I will let down the nets." St. Luke 5:5. One great part of the gospel stories is that the personality of the apostles can sometimes peek through the narrative. St. Peter could be described as the no-filter apostle. This trait is great when he is proclaiming Christ's messianship, bad when he tells Jesus he prevents him from dying on the cross, good when he declares his love for Jesus, bad when he denies him 3 times. However, we shouldn't be too hard on Peter. He is respectful as he calls Jesus master. However, the tone does sound a bit like a smarmy subordinate saying, "With all due respect, sir, this is a dumb idea." Just because one says love and respect does not mean that respect is on the forefront of one's mind. The important part is that despite not understanding the Lord's command, Peter does what he's told because the word of God compels him. Verse 6 through 7 tells us, and when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. What is the meaning of this miracle? Again, it isn't about everyone having a big fish lunch, or Peter in the game having made a prophet today. No, we have here a prophetic sign act. A prophetic sign act in which the future work of Peter and the other apostles is made concrete by the catching of a multitude of fish, remarkably after the word of God is preached. Empty nets before the word of God, full nets after. The word of God preached is what gives this miracle its meaning. How does Peter respond to this miracle? But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. This fascinating turn in the story does not meet our modern standards for the moment of glorious calling. After all, this incident is normally titled the calling of St. Peter. In so much modern fiction, a hero or heroine who will soon be called to greatness lives a common and unexceptional life, only to be discovered by some other character and whisked away to a life of glamour or exciting conflict. Every one of these stories aims at the heart of its viewer and says, the world just doesn't know how great you are. In your heart, you're a star. The problem with these stories is that they are half right. The world is full of lies that drag us into spirals of self-destruction. Lies that distract us from the glory that is ours to inherit. However, the message, what the film or story wants us to believe, is so desperately small and false when it tells us to look inward, to find our truth and power. The writers of these works all have a way that they look at the world, and that worldview comes through in their writing, it's inevitable. But it is so very different from the way that the world actually works. Is that better surprising? It really shouldn't be. When we read about the lives of screenwriters and actors and directors, do we come away with the impression that they have some deep knowledge of the universe? No. Their lives are the same broken disasters the biblical view of human nature lead us to expect to find, only made worse by the amplifying effects of money and power. But you may counter, are there not plenty of Christians who lead terrible lives? My only honest answer would be yes. After all, I am a pastor in God's church, and I sin. Now, how I treat sin and how I repent of it are wholly different from a non-believer, but the challenge still remains. Why should I believe what you are saying if you fail to live up to your own standards? The enormous difference between the modern screenwriter and the Christian pastor is that I am not asking you to believe in me. Ultimately, the lie of just believe in yourself and its cousin, look inside to find your truth, is that it asks you to believe in yourself because someone else who believes in himself told you to. You too can buy into this personal belief Ponzi scheme. All you have to do is to convince two other people to believe this, utter nonsense, and then they will convince two other people, and the mass delusion will just grow from there. Unfortunately, just like all Ponzi schemes, the returns turn out to be too good to be true, as the false comfort of all those people believing the same thing as you melts away. And all you are left with is nothing but the broken promises of an industry designed to take your money and tell you a story. Christianity is not asking you to believe in me or yourself. Christianity is the truth that can only come from the God who created us and became one of us. Christianity is true because it is the word of God. Simon Peter did not have to contend with the pathetic groupthink that goes on within our entertainment media today, but he knew what it meant to be confronted by his king. Again, he fell on his knees and begged for mercy, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. We see this same pattern in the Old Testament when the prophet Isaiah is confronted by the living God during his own commissioning ceremony. He writes, "Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Isaiah 6:5. Or the calling of the prophet Ezekiel. It writes, "Like the appearance of the bow that is in the cloud on the day of rain, so was the appearance of the brightness all around. Suddenly was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. And when I saw it, I fell on my face, and I heard the voice of one speaking." Ezekiel 1:28. The only appropriate response to the goodness and power and love of God is to recognize how unworthy we are to be in his presence. This fact is one reason why we say our general confession on our knees and beg God for forgiveness in every single one of our services. Many churches are moving away from kneeling or the confession of sins, supposedly because all that kneeling and asking for forgiveness of our sins is a downer and gets in the way of feeling good about ourselves. Again, this idea is a reflection of that unbiblical worldview we just discussed. Peter and all those who truly repent their sins know the utter terribleness of our sinful actions and desperately appeal to God, who has every right to destroy us for our rebellion. Peter did not look cool, falling on his knees on that boat. He did not look like a man in charge of anything as he begged for mercy. He looked like a man honoring something so much greater than himself, a truth that makes everything else immaterial. And he showed that truth by falling to his knees and confessing his sins. Finally, the response of Jesus changes the world. He says, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." What does it mean to hear God say to you, "Don't be afraid"? What a command to receive. For what does one have to fear if God himself has lifted that yoke off one's shoulder? What possible terrors can one's imagination summon that cannot be banished by his comforting word of God? The answer, of course, is nothing. For built into this command to cleave fear from his very existence is the positive assurance that God will never depart from it. A promise kept on that Pentecost morning when this same brass fisherman was molded by God the Holy Spirit into the fiery preacher whose first sermon would bring thousands to kneel at his master's knees. In fact, God would use this fisherman to spread his word throughout the world like a great net, pulling rebellious man into closer and closer relation to his God and master. This fisherman will write the beautiful epistle we read this morning. This fisherman will take the word of God, the word he heard that morning on that boat. He will take that word to the throne of the Roman Empire, and he will die doing it. But he will die without fear, serving the great commission that beckons us all. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heaven and the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head of all.
Thank you.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ Church. Almighty and ever living God, who by thy holy apostle hast taught us to make prayers and supplication and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity in godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose of the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace to Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, and they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively words, and rightly newly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation of your presence, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we humbly beseech you of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Especially Sherry, Dawn, Dana, Terry, Gabby, Danny, and Shay. Dwight. Lisa. Sherry, Britta, Gloria, Frank, Francis, Pay, Jennifer, Jared, Pat, Tiffany, John, Judy, and all of them are ours before them. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants, departed this tonight, who departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially Gabe and the elders. Teach thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, through Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. You who truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and in love and charity for your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near to me, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God about Him.
Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and commit all our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most seriously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and our hearts are sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who has great mercy and promised forgiveness of sins to all those with hearty repentance and true faith come unto them, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Here we crumble the words our Savior Christ said, and all truly turn to Him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, the end and all that believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also St. Paul said, this is the true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also St. John said, if any man said, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and He is the propitiation for our sins.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We Not playing our
pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. And now, as the Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
oh,
holy mysteries, through the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and left assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness toward us, and that we are very members in corporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom for the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, who said to the nine apostles, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Regard our sin with the faith of thy church, and grant unto that peace and unity which is according to thy will, who livest and reigns with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Peace of God, who passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds and knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus.